I'm going to do something a little bit different for this review. Normally I review a single movie or series on its own merit, but there's a particular movie and its remake that I've always liked, The Lost World. Both the 1925 silent film and the 2001 made-for-TV version were movies I grew up with, so rather than give each one its own separate review, I thought, why not just make a video comparing the two? And while I'm at it, I might as well read the book to see how they compare to the source material. So, without further ado, here's my analysis of both versions of The Lost World. First, a quick summary of the story. The Lost World centers around an expedition to find an undiscovered plateau in the Amazon rainforest where dinosaurs still live, headed by the intelligent but short-tempered Professor Challenger. The rest of the crew includes timid newspaper reporter Edward Malone, experienced hunter John Roxton, and stubborn Professor Summerlee. Sure enough, the Lost World is found along with its prehistoric inhabitants, but when the team's only escape passage is destroyed, they become marooned and must find a way home. After a series of dinosaur encounters, they find a way to escape and return home, but not before Professor Challenger brings along a prehistoric creature to prove what they found. A creature that soon escapes into the wild, to presumably never be seen again. There have been several adaptations since the book was written, but these are the two that are generally considered the best. Harry O. Hoyt's Lost World is not only the first silent movie I ever saw, it's also a classic adventure film and one of the most significant of its time. The special effects were unlike anything audiences had ever seen, as it was the first feature-length movie to use stop motion. It also introduced two story clichés that would later be used in countless dinosaur and monster movies to come. A group of people discovering an unknown island, mountain, jungle, or something of that nature, where dinosaurs still live, and they have to survive amongst the creatures until they can escape. The other cliché is that of a dinosaur or some other giant monster rampaging through a city. King Kong, Godzilla, The Land That Time Forgot, and tons of other movies owe at least a little to this revolutionary classic. Stuart Orme's Lost World probably isn't as significant in terms of cinematic importance, but it's still a good film on its own. The production value is surprisingly high for a direct-to-video movie, with talented actors like Bob Hoskins and the same special effects team behind Walking with Dinosaurs. The Intellidont from Walking with Prehistoric Beasts even makes a cameo. The question is, which movie adaptation holds up best? Well, for starters, let's take a look at the plot. The original Lost World is not a very story-driven movie and is more focused on the special effects. It takes the general outline of the book and does its own thing with it, creating new scenes and focusing a lot on the entertainment aspect. There's some development with the human characters, yes, but it knows people are really here for the dinosaurs. It creates several scenes of dinosaurs attacking people and fighting with each other. My favorite part has to be this scene where an Allosaurus and a Brontosaurus fight each other that ends with the Brontosaur falling off a cliff. Now that's pretty creative. How does all this compare to the book? Well, there are three major changes that this version makes. The first is that, in the book, our characters befriend a tribe of native people living on the plateau. The movie completely omits them from the story and instead keeps the focus on the dinosaurs. The second change is that the book ends with Challenger bringing a baby pterosaur back with him that escapes. The movie changes it to an adult brontosaurus that rampages through the city. It's an understandable change. This is a movie that wants to show more action, and a giant dinosaur causing damage to a city is a much bigger note to end on for an adventure movie. The third change I'll save for later, but let's move on to the remake. The new version follows the book a lot more closely, oftentimes going scene for scene. The tribe and the pterosaur are both included, as well as the slow build-up to the reveal of the dinosaurs. The book has the explorers trekking through the jungle for quite a long time and trying to find a way to climb up the plateau. In my opinion, the movie actually does a better job at keeping this part from becoming tedious by throwing in some interesting events and moments of character development along the way. There are some big changes this version makes as well, most notably with the ape men. In the book, as with the movie, the tribe and the ape men are longtime rivals, coming into conflict with one another. When our characters arrive and introduce guns, the battle turns in the tribe's favor, as Roxton helps them go out and drive the ape men from the jungle, which is meant to be seen as a triumphant moment. Made almost a century later, the movie views the deliberate extermination of a possibly intelligent species just because they're considered pests as, well, extremely immoral. Challenger actually takes pity on the ape men and tries to make peace with them. Unfortunately, this directly results in the ape men summoning two allosaurs to destroy the village, killing off much of the tribe. Side note, this scene was mentioned in the book only as one of the many events that happens, but the movie decides to expand on it and turn it into a climax. Another welcome change. It creates a confusing message. If Challenger had just let the ape men die, none of this would have happened. But on the other hand, killing these poor helpless creatures would have been cruel. So it comes off as the movie saying that sometimes there are no right answers and peace can't be achieved. It's kind of a sad moral to take away from an adventure movie. Another big change is that at the end, after the pterosaur escapes and the public becomes chaotic, the characters have an epiphany that maybe the plateau is best left undisturbed, that people will destroy it the way they've destroyed the environment already, hunting the dinosaurs and encroaching in on the tribe's homeland, so they claim to have made everything up and that the pterosaur was just a bird. This, again, is a welcome change because it adds a lot more of a solid ending to the story. In the book, Challenger is praised for his accomplishment and the fate of the plateau is left uncertain. The movie's ending is much more definitive and wraps up everything nicely. So, all in all, the remake is definitely more faithful to the book, but the original is still good because it's trying to be its own thing. Keep in mind, this was back when movies were still fairly new and people mostly just went for entertainment purposes. So in that regard, it succeeds. But if you're looking for a more faithful adaptation, the remake is definitely the better choice. Now let's discuss the characters. I already gave a brief description of the characters at the beginning, but let's decide which movie portrays them better, starting with Professor Challenger. I'm gonna be honest, when I read the book, I realized that the Challenger of the original was pretty much exactly like how he was described in the original source material. He's an absolute egomaniac, firmly convinced that he's the smartest person in the world, and that anyone who disagrees with what he says about the dinosaurs is just an idiot. Just look at the first image of him in the introduction, that says it all. The bushy beard and eyebrows, the huge frown, every time he's on screen he looks like he could explode with rage at any moment. And he often does. Nothing he does in this movie is ever out of character. He was definitely my favorite in both the movie and the book. The Challenger in the remake has a bit of that grouchy personality, but he's a bit more held back because they're trying to make him a more relatable, more three-dimensional character. You can understand where he's coming from, wanting to prove his worth and be taken seriously when everyone around him sees him as a joke. This, in turn, makes his choice at the end to lie about the plateau all the more gratifying because he sacrificed so much when he was so close to achieving his lifelong dream.
I can't do this. I can't! This is my chance to go down in history, shoulder to shoulder, with Galileo, Newton, Pasteur. I'll be one of the great men of science. No, I'm sorry, I won't do it.
It's also great seeing his rivalry with Professor Summerlee. The old cliché of two characters in a group of heroes who always bicker with each other only to become friends at the end has been done a million times before, and yet I never get tired of it. Watching these two work off each other, throwing one-liners back and forth, is always funny.
Your mind is as fossilized as the exhibits in your precious museums, Leo.
Lord Roxton, may I borrow your pistol? There's something that needs shooting.
I especially like the inside joke where Summerlee shows an outdated depiction of a dinosaur walking on its hind legs, dragging its tail, which scientists actually thought back in those days, and Challenger says it looked like the way we now know it did, and throws it in Summerlee's face when they see it in real life. John Roxton, the hunter, is hands down way better in the remake. In the original, we don't learn that much about him, but in the remake, he has a very well-defined personality. He's a womanizer, he's full of himself, he openly admits that he has no sympathy for the animals he kills, but they don't forget to give him a more human side. He respects the native people, he develops his own romance with one of them, and in the end, he sacrifices himself for the team, which actually was not in the book. So yeah, this aspect was definitely done better in the new version. Edward Malone is probably the most fleshed-out character in the book and in the original movie, going on this dangerous journey all to impress his girlfriend Gladys, only to find that she's left him for another man once he returns home. It would seem the whole journey was for nothing, but he did still do something brave and perhaps became a stronger person in the end. Once again, I think the remake portrays him better. The original makes his motivation clear, but the remake remembers to show that he's meant to be the average guy, acting like how any of us would in this situation. He's out of his element in the jungle, often a bit cowardly. He doesn't even know how to hold a gun properly, and is scared of non-poisonous snakes, apparently. Coincidentally, both the remake and the original make the same change from the book by adding a whole new character to the story to serve as a love interest for Edward, who goes along on the expedition. Both movies had the same idea to add a female character to fill the same role, but they're both totally different people. In the original, it's Paula White, the daughter of Maple White, the man who discovered and left a record of the plateau from which Challenger gets his information about it. This unseen character is canon to the book, but the daughter is purely the movie's creation, and she does give the journey a bit more weight. It's not just a trip to see dinosaurs, it's a rescue mission as well. And when it's discovered that Maple White died after returning to the plateau, it's a very emotional moment. In the remake, we get Agnes Clooney, a missionary the team meets in South America who joins because of her experience in the area. She's an interesting character as well as an essential member of the group, since her expertise comes in handy multiple times. Edward's relationship with her is certainly a lot more interesting than with Paula. In the original, the romance just kind of happens. Edward becomes convinced that they'll never make it back home and chooses to leave Gladys behind and marry Paula pretty suddenly. In the remake, Edward and Agnes don't get along at first, but over time they start to grow closer together. You really feel the chemistry between these two, how they clearly want to be together, but neither wants to come out and say it because they feel they shouldn't. I also like how, after Edward finds out Gladys dumped him, they don't just smile and get together like in the original. He has to explain that he's not just settling for his second choice. When they finally kiss at the end, it feels more earned because there was so much build-up to it. Finally, we have an extra character who wasn't in the book or the original movie. A reverend who becomes the villain, intentionally stranding the other characters on the plateau and later trying to kill them himself so that no one can ever find out about the lost world. I get what they're going for here. A religious fanatic trying to cover up scientific discovery, even going so far as to kill the scientists to keep his religion from being contradicted. That's actually pretty historically accurate. So, bottom line, the characters are much stronger in the remake than in the original. They're just all around more interesting and more three-dimensional. But enough about that, you're probably all sick of hearing me talk about people, so let's get down to what you really watch these movies for. The dinosaurs. Which movie had the better dinos? Keep in mind, better doesn't necessarily mean more realistic. I mean, obviously the remake has the more convincing creatures, but in the context of what technology was available at the time, the original really was quite an accomplishment. The dinosaurs still look great, even today. Apparently, the puppets had inflatable football bladders inside them so they could seem to breathe. Now that's attention to detail. They also act like real animals, not just mindless monsters. The Brontosaurus doesn't attack anyone or intentionally cause any damage. It's more scared and confused in this unfamiliar environment, and even a bit curious at times. Furthermore, even though the designs are outdated by today's standards, they were actually ahead of their time. Back in the 1920s, people still believed plant-eating dinosaurs lived in swamps and ate watercress, but the movie's dinosaurs are shown on land eating trees and even moving in herds. But when it comes down to it, the dinosaurs in the remake are definitely more realistic. The balance of practical and computer-generated effects is nicely done, and you have no trouble believing they're really there. And it's not just the dinos. The Ape Man makeup is incredibly detailed and convincing. Not to mention the actors really bring out the animalistic and human behavior as needed. So to sum up, even though both these movies were really well done, the remake is definitely superior in almost every way. More faithful to the book, more fleshed out characters, and more realistic special effects. Either way, I highly recommend both versions. They're both fun adventures that any dinosaur lover will enjoy.